Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Members of council, are there any disclosures of pecuniary interest this evening? I see none, so we'll move on to adoption of council minutes held November the 2nd. Looking for a mover and seconder. Councillor Verbeke, Councillor Hammond. Discussion on that motion. All in favor? And carried. Is there any business arising out of those minutes? I see none. There are no public meetings recorded or revision this evening, but we do have a bunch of reports from staff and delegations. First is one from delegation regarding a traffic safety concerns at Orange Street and Lutch Avenue. Is there a staff member starting this off, or are we just going right straight to delegation? Straight to delegation. So, Mr. Schieffer, if you want to come forward. And I'll just need you to push the talk button on there and introduce yourself and your address.
My name is Vince. My name is Vince Schieffer. I live in Fort Lodge. I represent the north end of Lodge Street. Last fall, I stopped a police officer and told him about speeding. He says, I know so. So I said, they're going 60, 70 kilometers an hour. And when I told him, I'd do something about it, he took off on me. Next week, we were walking on the east end of Orange Street, and there was two lodge. There were two girls with bikes on the east side of Orange Street. They were trying to cross lodge, but they couldn't because of the traffic. A gentleman stopped and let us come across. Another time, I was sitting outside and heard a tire squeals, and there was a little girl stood up on lodge with her hand up. Right, and the van stopped about 4 or 5 feet in front of her, and she was frozen. That's my opinion. There should be a four-way stop there before somebody gets killed. That's all. And then I went to see John Pilmer when we come home this fall here, and I told him about it, all this. And he said, when the school starts, you're going to put a speed trap down the school and a counting card, and a counting the cars. It's still not there today. I went to see him twice, and the secretary said he's too busy. So I'd like to know why there's no speed trap there and why there is no counting the car there. That's what he told me he was going to do. Nothing there yet.
Okay.
And I thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much. Mr. Botham, you have some comments?
Yes. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Just to address Mr. Schieffer's comments, we do recognize that you're just proposing to us that there is a speeding problem on Lutch, and you're finding that some of the students are having a hard time crossing Lutch Street, and your proposal is a four-way stop at Lutch and Orange, and you were looking for some information from John, and
that's what it pulled me out
of. Right, sure, certainly, and I just wanted you to understand that we're not ignoring your comments and we're not ignoring your concern. Frankly, we haven't gotten to it yet. We do have a number of issues in that area that we are looking at. And specifically with respect to the car counter or the speed trap, I think what John was referring to was another piece of equipment that we have that's it's a radar car counter, and it doesn't look like something you'd see on a highway with the numbers that flash and say you're doing this speed. It's just a small box, maybe a foot by a foot, that we strap to a... Well, we just got it this year. And we haven't had a chance to put it in place yet in your area, but we will. I have two other locations in town that we want to do the same thing at. And certainly when we get that data, we'll look at it, and we'll judge that against the other traffic sort of procedures that we follow. And I'm sure that will come soon in the new year.
Okay.
The whole north side of Lodge all have to come out here.
Sure.
Two, 300 cars at least a day coming out of there.
Yeah.
They never stop either.
Mr. Schiefer? Mr. Schiefer? If I could, actually, all of your comments are supposed to be directed at council, not at staff members. But what Alan is trying to tell you is that he's heard what you've said, not just tonight, but prior to that, and that his department will take the steps necessary to get to the point where you want us to be. So we know what to do, whether it is a four-way stop or whatever recommendations we may come up with. Well, you would hope it would, but yeah, well, a lot of people don't stop. But anyway, leave it with us. And Alan, do you have some more information to share with council?
Yes, I'd just like to inform council that we do have a traffic calming warrant now, and we got that. It's just a little process that we can go through and take data, and we can check off whether or not we need to do some kind of traffic calming in an area. And that came in the last revision to the short-term traffic plan. So we have that, and once we get all the traffic data, we'll certainly look at it, and we'll, if need be, we come back to council and make a proposal to change something in the area.
Okay, all right.
And my thing is, you know, if you're killing anybody here, yep.
No.
And you have a stop like that, like stop there, and kids can go across.
Understood. So I know council members, you've got a Councillor Verbeke had his hand up for a question.
Mr. Mayor, just, you know, when you travel through Cottom, sometimes they have the sign up there from the OPP, you know, speed 50, your speed, and it's the radar, and it's a huge one. It's 4x8 probably the other way. So, I mean, I can't see why, if the OPP has, if we can't use it out there, or else set up the cops there for a while just during time just to help out, to maybe make them aware.
Yeah, and from the police board's perspective, this is the first time we've heard of the Orange and Lutch situation. So, like all of the other street complaints we get, we will relay it. So, any other questions from the council on this? Okay, well then, Mr. Schiefer, thank you very much. Appreciate coming out this evening to let us know. Yep, appreciate it. We'll allow administration to do what they do. The second delegation this evening is one from the Leamington District Memorial Hospital, and we have Zane Ismail, Cheryl Dieter, and Connie Martin here to present to council.
All right, thank you everyone. Thank you, Mayor and Council, for your time tonight. My name is Zane Ismail, Manager of Innovation and Partnerships at Leamington Hospital.
I'm Connie Martin, Director at Maryvale.
And Cheryl Dieter, Chief Nursing at Leamington.
And tonight we just want to give you an update from our last presentation, I believe in August, about some of the initiatives we presented here that are going on at the hospital. So the very first one is regarding our mental health neighborhood, the neighborhood of care. Just to remind you that Leamington District Memorial Hospital is aggressively pursuing partnerships to create a mental health and addictions neighborhood of care, if you will, or a community hub within the hospital, within the ambulatory care wing of the hospital, right adjacent from the emergency room. Here's a graphic representation of some of the partners that we have, just to refresh your memory.
We've been undertaking a few pilots, and one of them being referrals to our emergency department. So when you come in 24/7 to emergency department, and we identify, one of the staff members identify that you would benefit from one of the neighborhood partners, a referral is made, so the next day you would be able to see someone, or within the 24 to 48 hours. As well, we wanted to make you aware that Leamington Hospital continues to be inundated, and I do mean inundated, with calls from Leamington District Secondary School, Cardinal Carter, and as well now Kingsville. Kingsville's actually, I do have to say, I need to meet with them, myself and the emergency department director, because they're actually using our fast track method for at Leamington High School. So everybody's in great need with our students. We do have a pending memo of understanding with the AIDS Committee of Windsor, which we'd be starting on a weekend to help address our migrant workers as well as other citizens here in Leamington. Pressures on volume continue to be looked at, and we have to justify our partnerships. So an example is the House of Saferstein. Just last week I informed that they weren't getting the numbers that were required. These partners we bring from Windsor, their resources that are Windsor-Essex, and I want to start saying Essex-Windsor, because we need our fair share here in the county. Now I'm going to introduce to you a perfect example of one of our partners who has expanded.
First of all, I have to say that I have been a resident of Leamington for 31 years, so it pleases me immensely to be able to say that the help for kids with mental health problems is now greater, thanks to Leamington Hospital. So there are two things that are happening now that you need to know, which is if you have a child up to 18 years of age, 0 to 18, there's a crisis response, and then there's a more long-term counseling response. So 7 days a week, you can take a young person to the emergency department. Through OTN, the telehealth network, they'll be connected with a Windsor counselor and a child psychiatrist, and direction will be given as to how to handle that crisis, which might mean admission to hospital. The second thing is that now 2 days a week, Wednesdays and Fridays, there is an on-site counselor at the hospital, and it can be a walk-in clinic. You don't have to have an appointment. You're worried about your child, you can't get your child there, you go. You find out what can be done, or you can have counseling. I have to tell you, the only reason this is in Leamington is thanks to your hospital, who have been very aggressive. Normally, organizations don't invite other organizations into their space. Leamington Hospital is, and that's why that's now there for kids, and it wasn't there a year ago. Thank you.
No, the thanks is you. I've been asked, so where's the need? Why do you need it in Leamington? Look at these numbers. These are just drug-related infractions, and I'm telling you this, that what this means is, yes, people, Leamington, look at the 122. That means that addictions are something that are alive and well here. We are a hot spot, and as citizens, we have no choice but to embrace this and bring the services back home here where they're needed.
Another one of our initiatives that we spoke of last time is sort of in the innovation space and how Leamington Hospital is working with a number of different app developers to bring mobile health solutions to Leamington. And we're happy to announce that on November 24th, in partnership with Leamington High School, Mind Your Mind, the folks here at Maryvale and Cardinal Carter, we're going to be launching the Be Safe app at 10 a.m. in the morning, and we want to invite all of you to be there to see this happen.
Please come.
You'll hear from people like Cheryl and the folks at Mind Your Mind who created this app, so please join us on that day.
And why I'm asking you to come is this, that we were actually challenged by some persons in Windsor that, why would you have a launch in Leamington? No one will come. Oh, yes, we will. Wait and see.
So this will take place in the gymnasium at Leamington District Secondary School. They've been so kind to offer us that space.
So updates for other areas within the hospital. I wanted to let you know that there will be 10 rehab beds that will be opening as of December 1st, 2015, as well a gathering place, a cafe. We're under construction right now, and it's an open concept area in the front of the hospital whereby coffee will be served 24/7, because we do expect to be serving our neighborhoods and as well as our community. We also have offered and extended an offer for an obstetrician to start January 2016, so that's very exciting. Our emergency room, P4R funding, something that our municipality needs to know about is that we are at risk for $800,000 loss at the hospital. Why? Visits to date are 25,612. We've received a letter from the Ministry of Health saying that we are at risk because we may not meet the 29,000 visits that we need to have to get the $800,000. What does that mean? That's quite a few jobs. Last year, we fell short by 364 visits to meet the 29,000. That's one visit per day. That's so close, but yet so far. The variance right now is 3,388 visits. That's as of today. By the end of December, we need to have the 29,000 visits, or your hospital, our hospital, will lose $800,000. That's the equivalent of 8 FTEs. Big deal here in Leamington. There's no way we're going to let that go, right? So what I'm going to continue to do moving forward is update you on these challenges that come, but together, I do believe we can solve these issues. As the municipality joins with healthcare, we are one of the major employers here, and I do believe together we can make a difference.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Now, before you take off, let's see if there's any questions from council. Are there any questions, Council? Councillor Hammond?
Your Worship, thank you. Cheryl, I'm sorry, I forgot the time of the opening. I didn't get it off the board. Is it 10 o'clock?
Oh,
for the 24th of November?
Oh, it's at 10 a.m.
10.
Yes.
10 a.m.? Okay.
10 o'clock. Please come. And we're going to have all the grade 9 and 10 students there. Kyle Barrage has been very, very, the principal there has been very, very helpful in organizing this. As well, the kids will be catering.
And short of going out and causing accidents, what can we do to increase the numbers to the emergency ward to get us to that 800,000?
Well, you don't want to cause accidents, I agree, but please come. The wait time is certainly the shortest in all of the Erie St. Clair Lynn, and we're there to serve you. It's not that far, right? 3,338 visits, that's all we need till December 31st. So please use your ED.
All right, thank you.
I think I had Councillor Jacobs. No, you're good.
Yep. Thank you, Worship. Cheryl, is this program that you have for this mental health, is it in conjunction with the OPP program that has been presented to us? Are you working
That is one
hand
of the partners. The mental health response team is one of the partners that certainly assists, and they do come into the organization. So one of the 18 partners.
And you mentioned earlier that this program is like aimed at the at schools currently?
No, it's the neighborhood of care serves all for mental health and addictions, no matter what the age. The one partner that we're hoping to come soon is the RCC, the Regional Children's Center. That's one that we've been actively pursuing, and we know those are for children that are under the age of 12, right? And I can tell you right now that what's happening within our county is that parents are having to take a day off work, gather a child, go up to Windsor, you know, driving. It's not easy when you have children with needs, exceptional needs. So we keep pulling in these partners hard and fast, and we won't let them go easily.
If I may, one more with that, though, like in conjunction with the current one that we have in operation now with the OPP,
mm-hmm.
like that has relieved a lot of the stress on the eMERGE, I guess, and
John,
the facilities.
I would say it's scratched the surface. It has not relieved. We certainly have fast-tracked, and we're certainly working in conjunction with the OPP, but when you see the numbers that we have, you know we could use another unit, and we could use them based right out of the hospital. That's for sure. So we have one. We have a team that's been assigned to this area, but the work is endless. We're a hot spot.
So with this hot spot, as you're mentioning, then, do we have enough staff and facilities to handle this? Like, what's going to happen if you're going to be inundated with an exceptional amount of these cases?
John, we're ready and we're willing, and we'll deal with those ebbs and flows. We need to do this. The need is so, it's a real mission field out there. And I do believe that a lot of it, we have put our heads down and not paid attention to what's been going on around us. And that's why when you hear Mary say it's unusual for people to invite others in, we need all the help we can get. And we need to recoup or gain our fair share. Resources have been allocated to Windsor, Essex. I'm saying it needs to start being Essex, Windsor.
And I guess, at us. And I guess that's where I was going with it. Like, with the amount of activity you might generate, or you are generating, from this type of a program, are we going to be able to fund it? And if you say those funds could be funneled in reverse as they're going currently, then we would be.
I'm working actively. Our hospital works actively with the Erie St. Clair Lynn, so we will ensure that the resources meet the need. Continuing to advocate. That's the key.
Okay, thank you very much. Real quick, the location of Mind Your Mind, was it at LD?
Yes, LDSS.
Okay.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Councillor Dunn?
Through your Worship, Cheryl, my question is that if I book through my doctor for an x-ray or something, would that be counted in the emergency? That doesn't count in for the visits?
No, but DI is important too. The activity in our diagnostic imaging is important as well. So definitely using the resources here at our hospital. I can tell you that some individuals have been told that if they needed a CAT scan or a mammography, they need to go to Windsor. We've got state of the art equipment here. You can insist that your appointments be booked at the hospital, and that helps as well.
Councillor Wilkinson.
Thank you, Your Worship. Marianne, can I get you back up to that the jug infraction slide? Oh, okay, Zane, thank you. I was writing down that number, 122 down to 33 is the next one.
So look at that proportionately. That's huge.
It's shocking. It's incredible.
Now, couple with that what we heard from the United Way, that just under 40% of our citizens here in Leamington have a grade 12 education.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I heard you say that a few weeks ago. Now, I'm wondering what type of partnership, I just heard you talking about the conjunction you do have with OPP. Mm-hmm. These type of stats here that are quite shocking. Are you sharing those, of course, with the OPP? And what is OPP, the feedback
this is from,
they're given?
This is from the OPP.
And you're tackling the problem of care, from people that suffer from drug problems. Does the OPP ever say to you what they're doing to fight the problem at the front lines, though? Are they putting more units in Leamington to try?
You know what? They're not equipped to be dealing with mental health and addictions. That's why the partnering and dovetailing with us is so important. That's why you have to look back. Remember in the old days when the police used to bring in donuts to the emergency department? Mm. Want to know what the key was? Relationship. It's about those OPP officers knowing that nurse, that physician will meet them at the door, and they care about the individual that they're bringing in so that they can be quickly relieved and return back to duty. Their job is to protect and guide that citizen who's struggling into our emergency department where we can filter them. Not some don't need to come to the emergency department, you're correct. But our role as a community hospital is that we need to relieve those officers of that individual, that gentle handoff, so they can get back out, right?
Right.
So
when I look at these, though, I think this would be a good discussion when you talk about at our police association meetings, is just get the opinion of police. Yeah. What they think about.
They love the mental health response unit. I can tell you that. They love that mental health response unit. Blake has been instrumental as well as implementing this in Byron. And I know they would love this to grow even further. And of any place for it to grow, right here at home. So.
Okay, if there are no further questions from council, then Zane and Connie and Cheryl, thank you very, very much for coming up this evening. Alrighty. So our next delegation this evening is the Leamington Chamber of Commerce, and in regard to the labor market study. So we have Wendy Parsons and Denise Graham.
Good evening, Your Worship, Mayor Patterson, members of council and staff. As general manager of the Leamington District Chamber of Commerce, we are here to present an update to you on the Leamington Labor Market Project and Study. Our agenda for tonight is straightforward. We will provide some background on the project, show how it connects with what the municipality is working on currently, detail the phases of the work and our progress to date, and share with you a few insights into what we have learned so far. Finally, we will let you know what next steps and results you can expect from our team. As you may know, the Chamber wrote a grant last winter, and we were accepted by the Ministry of Training, Colleges and Universities. And in May, we began to start our funding with both the primary and secondary research into the local labor market, its demographic makeup, labor supply by job code, areas for increased demand for labor, and et cetera. All this analysis was undertaken as a result of the economic shock caused by the closure of the Heinz facility. We wanted to have the best, most current information about the skills and the people in our community to help position us for future growth and success. Our study will help us effectively project the future labor market needs in Leamington, the local area, and identify and address any gaps between the skills and the existing workforce and those needed to support future business growth. This work aligns very closely with two of the council's key areas for focus, community development and economic development. In terms of community development, one of the critical components of that is ensuring that the workforce has the right skills. Workforce development includes education, job-specific training, and career and succession planning. As well, the Chamber views itself as a key community partner interested in assisting Leamington to grow and develop. Finally, we have included numerous community and business leaders in our process. As to economic development, that will arise naturally from the work in enhancing our labor force. Our project's results will provide a roadmap for improving the skill development within our workforce. This will mean better recruitment and retention of employees for local businesses and increased productivity as we impact and augment labor market access. And as part of this, we had our steering committee. We created for the labor market, and that consists of myself, Dave Campbell as past president, and he's the chair of the steering committee. We have Janine Lasseline Berglund, our representative from the municipality, and Wayne Warham, our local entrepreneur from Warham's Jewelry, and from the agribusiness sector, we have Dave Dick. Finally, through an RFP process, the committee screened a number of applicants and hired Denise Ganim of Ganim Consulting to fill the role of labor market specialist. I'll now turn the floor over to Denise to talk a bit about the research process, some interesting insights we have gained so far, and then the next step in this work. Denise?
Thank you very much, Wendy. Good evening, Your Worship and Council. So I want to talk to you a little bit about the process that we had outlined to undertake for this project. It was a multi-phased approach. The first thing that we started with was a demographic snapshot of the community, and that's to get an understanding of who actually makes up the workforce in the Leamington area. What do they look like in terms of education and work skills? Because that's critically important for us to understand as we move forward in terms of workforce development. The next step in the process, we identified that there are five critical sectors in the economic development plan that Leamington is working towards, and we put together focus groups and a series of individual one-on-one interviews in all of those sectors. And those sectors are tourism, agribusiness, manufacturing, healthcare, and small business. We've completed that portion of the project, and we'll talk a little bit about some of those insights shortly. The next phase of the project is something that we call econometrics, and essentially that is taking the existing data that we do have about the Leamington area, economic data as well as demographic data, updating it because most of it's based on the 2011 census, and so we know there's been some significant changes in the community since that period of time. So getting that updated information, figuring out what that tells us and what that means in terms of changes in the community. And then building that into essentially a forecasting model. So we're looking at both the demand side of labor, what do organizations need, where is their growth in the economy, which organizations are growing, and what kind of labor do they want, and the supply side of labor. So who's in our workforce now? Who's coming into our workforce, who might be leaving our workforce. So trying to understand then how those two things match up. The next phase of the project, some community consultation. This may be where we might be tapping some of you on the shoulder and asking for some of your time to interview you or your thoughts on how community is progressing and developing, what are maybe some of the key areas that we need to focus on as a community, and certainly other community leaders that we will be tapping into. Phase five, once we have put the forecast model together and we're looking at a 1, 3, and 5 year planning time frame, we'll bring that model back to a number of the key stakeholders in the community and get them to validate it. And finally, the last phase will be after we have the model, gathered up all of this information, qualitative and quantitative data, and assessed it, we will write a final report. with some recommendations on what we believe might be the next steps going forward for the community in terms of increasing and enhancing that labor market. So, what's happened so far? Well, we have finished the preliminary labor market report, which is that demographic snapshot that I talked about. I've brought copies for you. Makes some wonderful bedside reading, puts you right to sleep. And I'll leave with that as well my business card. If after you've read through the information that's there, you have questions or comments or something jumps out at you. There was a very interesting little population spike in 2012 that I have yet to get a good answer from anyone of what might have caused that. So be interested from council members' perspective if something rings true to you. So I'll leave those here for anybody who's interested with my business cards as well. Next, we've completed the 5 focus groups and a number of individual interviews with a wide cross-section of business leaders in the community. And we've had probably 50 plus people that we've spoken with already and gathered that input. We have a few more of those community-based interviews still to do. One of the things that we did come across, as much as there was incredibly positive response from the business community in terms of being involved and wanting to participate in the process, that doesn't always translate into actually being able to do it. So it was a lot of challenges around scheduling and rescheduling focus groups and trying to get people together and, you know, giving up on some of that and having to go do one-on-one interviews. But suffice it to say, it's always a challenge to get good community involvement. I was pleasantly surprised at the positive support that we did get, but it didn't come without its struggles. We're working right now on that expanded data analysis portion. That's currently what the project team is focused on, and we're putting together that we're hoping to have that forecasting model finalized probably by the end of December. As part of that process, one of the things that we did do, I'm not sure if you're familiar with something called the Delphi technique, in case you haven't heard of it before, essentially it's a consensus building tool. And so what we did with everybody who participated in the focus groups or was tapped on for a one-on-one interview, we asked them to give us their forecasted economic growth percentages 1, 3, and 5 years for the Leamington area and also for the province of Ontario as a whole. So we gathered all that data up, calculated the mean score and the standard deviation. Now we have sent that information back out to all those participants. So here's the average, here's the standard deviation, and then we also supplied, this time, what we would call expert opinion, Bank of Canada, Conference Board of Canada, federal government budget, probably most of the major banks or their economic arms, and that information either for Canada or for Ontario. We don't have anybody doing a forecast specifically for the Leamington area. Then we've asked all the participants to resubmit their forecasts based on that information that we've shared back with them. Then it'll go out a third time just with the revised mean score and standard deviation. What you find when you do this essentially is that the standard deviation gets smaller and smaller each time you do this. And what that does then essentially gives us a consensus of what the business leaders in this community believe will be the growth factor 1, 3, and 5 years for our community and for Ontario as a whole, and those will be the numbers that we will use in our forecasting model. So we'll have some buy-in, if you will, from the community, from the business leaders, to the model that we create that will help to say where are we in terms of the demand and supply for labour. So that model is taking shape. As I said, we're still working on all the components right now. And we have begun that next phase of the community leader consultation. So as I said, don't be surprised if you get a phone call from me or an email, and I'm sure you'll all be thrilled to sit down and tell me what you think. Okay, some of the things that we've learned so far from the project. So some insights, and one thing that really struck me is there was some negative population growth from the 2006 to the 2011 census data for Leamington. Now, there's always a bit of a challenge when we're talking about census data because they have different ways of aggregating the data, so we can't always break out exactly what we want. But when you look at what they call the census subdivision, which is Leamington and Kingsville together, there was some modest growth, 0.7%. But when you break it down a little further, there was actually some slight decline in Leamington, slight growth in Kingsville. You'll see by comparison, I just put a couple of other communities, Chatham-Kent had an even significantly lower rate of population decline. Peely, the percentage is huge, but that's probably about three people. And then, of course, Lakeshore, by comparison, 3.9% growth in that same period where we experienced only 0.7% growth. So why that's critically important, of course, is because population growth drives economic growth and community development. And that, of course, is connected in then to labor market development and growth. So it's not necessarily that it's a negative, it's just something that we need to be aware of and factor into our model when we look at what it means. When we look at the makeup of our workforce, a couple of things that jumped out as really interesting facts, probably no surprise to any of you, of course, but the large percentage of people in this area for whom neither French nor English is their first language, so the language spoken, and that here is 19.5% versus 14.4% for all of Ontario, which includes the GTA, which has, you know, more than 50% visible minority population at this point in time. So we have a higher percentage of non-English and French-speaking people than all of the rest of Ontario. And when you compare it, I'm doing data comparisons right now to other agricultural communities to see how it stacks up in some of those communities, and we'll have that data in the final report. The other thing that's interesting, and I actually heard the speakers from the hospital allude to it, and that is the educational attainment levels in our community. And from a workforce development perspective, that's a critically important issue, because if you look at the way jobs are changing, requirements for at least a high school education at a minimum, and certainly for higher levels of post-secondary education, those demands are increasing, and we do not have a population base right now that has that level of education. So for post-secondary, we have 41% versus 69.5% Ontario-wide. That's a huge gap. And in the middle section of our population base, which makes up the bulk of the workforce, age 25 to 44, we have 32% who do not have a high school degree versus 9.5% as the national average. Those are some concerning numbers, and that will certainly drive some of the recommendations that we are making coming out of the rest of the analysis of the data as we get it. So what are things that we as a community can do to develop that workforce to help people complete high school if they have not had that opportunity? What are things we can do within our high school programs to build in perhaps co-op components that will keep people engaged in school and staying till they are able to complete their high school? What are things that we can do with local education delivery institutions like St. Clair or Ridgetown that could bring maybe post-secondary opportunities to this community? So those are some of the things that we're starting to think about and work on as we work towards our final report. Okay. On the positive side, some of the insights that we've gained so far, particularly from the focus groups, while it's interesting that we have this diversity from a language perspective, I see a tremendous amount of strength in the diversity within this community in terms of opportunity, particularly if you look at how a number within the agribusiness and within a number of other organizations, international trade is growing to have a very diverse population base that speaks a number of different languages can be a real strength and could be a real opportunity for Leamington in terms of moving forward. Certainly the high level of community collaboration, even the process itself of just bringing various people together, business owners who are involved in the same sector, many of whom had not sat in the same room before, and having them in for a focus group, talking about some of these issues around the labor market, there was a lot of great exchange that went on between business owners, and some positive things that are already happening in terms of some collaborations coming out of just that initial process. And as we continue with a few more phases of this study, I think we'll have other opportunities to bring people together, and that, I think, is very beneficial to the community as a whole. There is growth happening in a number of those five key sectors that we're looking at, and I'm talking some strong economic growth, which is good news for the community in terms of rebuilding and growing as a result of the loss of that major employer. And again, just the incredibly positive feedback and outlook that we got from the participants and the interviewees that were involved in the process so far. So a lot of really good energy, I guess is how I would put it, happening in the community, particularly in those various business sectors. And I think that bodes well for the future. So what we still have to do. Obviously, we've talked a little bit about the qualitative data that we've gathered. Now we have to analyze it. Get those and the quantitative data as well. We have to get the focus groups. The theme report is almost written, and that will probably be released by the end of this month. The updated demographics and the beginnings of the model are underway, and that should be done by the end of December. We would be looking to validate the model with stakeholders in the community sometime in January, and then from that come up with our recommendations, write the final report, and have that done by the end of March. So. That's everything that we had to share with you. We'd be happy to answer any questions that you might have for us.
Thank you very much. Questions, Deputy Mayor?
No question, really, Mr. Mayor. Thank you. I have to say, Denise, originally when the announcement for the grant came about, I really expected someone to come in and shuffle some numbers around and come up with some conclusions. But you have involved many people in our community, and I'm very, very impressed with that. This is a document then that's got some teeth in it, if you will. Beyond just the figures, you've got the personal aspects, and sitting and interviewing and talking to the different stakeholders I'm truly impressed. I did not expect this on this level. I really thought it was going to be very clinical. Lots of numbers and very, what's the word, academic conclusions. So I have to see, alone in your presentation, it's very delightful how you've come across. It's made it easy for those of us who abide by the keep it simple, stupid philosophy and so many things. It made it very easy to understand.
Thank you.
But also very interesting, and the fact that you're involving so many people and getting the layers in our community. Those of us born and raised here know those things. We may not know the numbers, but we know, like John just mentioned to me, well, we know why so many do not have a grade 12 education. We know the culture that's doing that, but now we've got some background, we've got facts and figures. So I commend you on, first of all, the numbers that you've gathered, but also the way in which you've done it. So I'm certainly expecting wonderful conclusions at the end. So
no pressure, no pressure.
But thank you very much, and to the chamber too. I have to say I'm very impressed with this. Thank you.
Thank you for the comment. Actually, I was just going to say I think this is obviously part of the way the process that my company likes to do business when it does this kind of work. But the fact that I was able to get so many participants from the community speaks to Wendy and the chamber and the kind of network that they've built with the business owners in Leamington, so that people, when Wendy picked up the phone and said, Denise would like to talk to you, they said, sure. So I think I have to say thank you to the chamber for the great work that they do in terms of the network that they've built and the support that they give to the business community, so that people were willing to come out when we asked them to.
Councillor Hammond.
Your Worship, thank you. Denise, I want to further the comments made by Deputy Mayor in the fact that I, too, am really impressed with the presentation here. Somewhat surprised, not shocked, but surprised, I guess. And I'm looking forward to, and I'm sure we all are looking forward to seeing the finalization of your report. I think it'll make for some good reading. And thank you. And to Wendy Parsons, I think it's be a great opportunity to congratulate you on the Business Excellence Awards evening you put forward between you and the entire chamber. It was a great night, and I thank you for it.
No other questions? Councillor Jacobs?
Thank you, Your Worship. Just if I may, you mentioned the growth in five key sectors. Are you at liberty to disclose those, or are you, like, where are those sectors? Or what are those sectors?
Okay, so the five sectors that we focused on, part of it was in alignment with what your economic development office is already working on. So those sectors are manufacturing. So we have a number of very niche manufacturers in this community, all of whom are actually in a growth phase, surprisingly enough, despite some of the declines that we've seen in the broader automotive manufacturing sector. Those that are located in this community have found their niche, even those that are automotive related are still experiencing some growth. Tourism, obviously, is a driving sector in this community, and that's tied very closely to the small business sector. Those ones, the growth numbers weren't as strong yet, but I think there was a lot of potential shown there, and certainly some positive things happening. There's investment happening in some of the hotels where there's renovations and refurbishment going on. There's a lot of restaurants that are seeing uptick in numbers of and sales and that type of thing. So there's some energy happening around there. The healthcare sector, I mean, I don't have to say anything because you already saw those guys. They're awesome. It's a lot happening in the healthcare sector. And then the last one, agribusiness. There is huge growth potential happening there. And it's everything there from the expertise that this area has developed in the greenhouse sector. If you look at the demographic of the North American population, the fact that we are, the baby boomers are aging, and we're all starting to take better care of ourselves, so there's been an increase in people wanting fresh fruits and fresh vegetables at a reasonable price year-round, so of course the greenhouse industry is able to provide that, so there's huge growth happening in both the regular growing and processing sector, and particularly in the greenhouse sector. So, you know, I will have more firm numbers as we finish gathering up some of that data that's in the next phase of the analysis piece, but that's from the qualitative data, that's what we've learned so far.
So in essence, then, we are not looking at one specific area. Our potential is out there that we have different areas of manufacturing and so forth, so we are able to build and expand on those particular areas. So that's good news, and I think that's... We're not focused in one particular area. Thank you so much.
It's not a one-horse pony. Yeah.
So then ultimately for me, I thank you, the Chamber of Commerce, and Dave and Wayne and all of you who have been involved on this steering committee to take a lead like this. This is something that I've always hoped the Chamber of Commerce would do, so good on you. And I too look forward to the end results of this report. One of the things that sticks out kind of as a, I don't know, interesting conflict is that most recently Leamington was named as in the top 10 entrepreneurial municipalities in Canada, and yet, as we all know, when you pointed out again tonight, is we have way above average lack of education. How do you get the two together to make sense? So do you really need school to be the entrepreneur?
That's a great question, which I won't answer. Okay. But what I will say is I think one of the things that, an idea that it's already percolating here is how do we take the great entrepreneurs that we have in this community and get them working with our high school kids to get them thinking at an early age about starting their own businesses. And, you know, could be everything from, you know, getting a chapter of junior achievement here through to internship and mentorship programs in some of the successful businesses that we have here. But you don't necessarily have to have education, but you certainly need to have experience to be successful as an entrepreneur. Maybe we can pass that on as our way to educate the next generation of entrepreneurs. So just something that's already, like I said, We're not at the report recommendation phase yet, but no. That doesn't mean I'm not already thinking. So.
Right. And the other one that I want to touch on, and you can or don't have to answer it at this point in time, we have always been led to believe that it is a cultural group that affects us the most in the education level. But when I talk with the other groups that are looking at poverty and all that kind of things in our area, not just Leamington, but in Essex County, they indicate that's not necessarily the real factor, that it spreads across all cultures, our lack of education here. Is that what you have found as well?
That's what the data has indicated so far. It is a fairly broad cross-section of the community. You'll see when you look in the preliminary report here that has the demographic snapshot, and I've highlighted some of that detail. I haven't gone into too much depth here. We essentially made this report to make a talking point to start the focus groups, mm-hmm. So it hasn't got too much depth of detail, so we didn't want to overwhelm people. We wanted to give them some things to talk about, but we didn't want to overwhelm them. But it's the interesting variances across the various age categories as well. So again, there's there's a number of reasons that play into that, but certainly it isn't just one particular cultural group. It is more broadly based than that, and it covers not just lack of completion of high school, it also does cover those who have finished but choose not to do post-secondary.
Yep.
So again, it's got some more broader reaching effects as well.
That'll be very, very interesting. So we look forward to that final report. So thank you very, very much for coming this evening. Okay, so then we'll move on to our next delegation, which is the one from Janine Lasland Berglund, our Economic Development Officer. You have the floor.
Thank you, Mayor, Deputy Mayor, and Council Members. I love it when you call me a delegation. It makes me feel larger than life. thanks again. It's been a little over 6 months since I've checked in with Council. And I thought it timely to provide you with now an update of a year's worth of activity. So we're going to go through a lot of stuff tonight, some of which is going to obviously be fostered by some of the partners that came in to share their information here tonight. So without further ado, let's just take a look back. About 6 months ago, the information that I used to present to you at that time was giving you a sense of activity of what I was engaged in or what we as a municipality were engaged in, but also some quantifiable information on what we had discovered about Leamington and where it was today, which was information at the time that didn't seem readily available. So just quickly, we did a sector snapshot and really came to some fine-tuned information about what our key sectors are, and that was a combination of tax assessment and growth potential and all kinds of weird formulas that go into those calculations. But as a reminder, agribusiness was our largest sector, manufacturing, healthcare, which is I think a huge surprise to everyone, tourism, which I think was another surprise because we don't think of it as an economic driver, as well as small business. The other things we talked about with the number of folks that we were engaged with at the time, spent a lot of time out in our community talking and listening, more important, listening to people, we got a sense of where the growth potential was happening and who was doing what. The other thing that we did was start to engage with partners in our community to get a sense of what they were doing and how this might all roll into one larger picture so that in the event we needed to work together, which ultimately we do, that we were all going to be rowing the boat, if you will, towards the same goal and in the same direction. So since that time, gathering all of this information, I thought it probably would make sense now to look at a more strategic approach to how we're going to move forward with community and economic development. This will be more in line with some of the discussions that we've had in the past about then, well, how do we prioritize and how do we organize this information? So here's the big picture. Every municipality, if you will, has these key objectives. They all want it to be a great place for people to live. They want it to be a great place for business growth. And more importantly, they want it to be a great place for people to visit. And so you look at any municipal website in any community that's roughly our size, you'll see these three pillars. And how do they connect that information? So what's key for Leamington, though, is what's contained inside of each of these initiatives. So for us in the LIVE model in community economic development, that really is the community development piece. How do we continue to coordinate resources and work with partners to make sure this is an awesome place to live? In the work portion, that's really our hardcore economic development activity. And in the play portion, now we're talking about tourism and the impacts of tourism. Inside of each one of these, then, is a unique approach to what's important to Leamington. So let's just start quickly with community development, and I'm going to really rush through these. We can engage in more discussion another time, or certainly have the question period to ask me specific questions, but I think some of these will not be a surprise to anyone. So part of our initiatives here in community development will be coordinating our community partners and building, and we'll call it an engagement model, that keeps them involved in the discussion about what we're doing. The seven key areas that we're looking at, though: poverty reduction, which it shouldn't be a surprise to most of you, workforce development, which we heard a little bit about tonight, cultural diversity, urban renewal or downtown revitalization, depending on how you want to look at it, youth engagement, a healthy community, and then accessible services or asset mapping, if you will. Under the economic development pillar, we're talking about our five key sectors and how do we support and position them for growth. Again, agribusiness, manufacturing, healthcare. You'll notice tourism is in a different color, and that's because the breadth and depth that needs to go into our tourism strategy actually requires a plan all by itself. In this case, it's under play, like I said, and we're calling it tourism. So here are some categories that have been popular for growth in other communities, which are also assets in this community. Things like sports tourism, which has been on the minds of a lot of folks around here lately, certainly with the amenities that we have in this community. Culinary tourism, which is very, very popular. Our proximity to wine country certainly is we'll call it an asset to us. But how does cultural diversity on the community development side play a role perhaps in culinary activity here with respect to foods and the epicure experience? Certainly the celebration of diversity and culture has an impact in this area as well. Ecotourism, so this is really taking advantage of all of our natural resources. Culture, arts, and heritage, which we have plenty of, including, you know, our own museum, a couple of museums, an arts center, and the Bank Theater, which is a little gem in our backyard. Our waterfront marina and beaches, our largest attraction here is actually water. Because we've all likely grown up in this area or have been close to water in southern Ontario, we don't think of our access to water as being an attraction point, but it actually is in other places in Ontario and Canada where they don't have proximity to fresh water like we do. Lots of other festivals and events, and I have under there something unique, which is agriculture. And is agriculture really a tourism point for us? We know that other communities have looked at their economic development activity and turned it into a tourism activity. The most recent example that I've experienced is a trip that I got to take with our healthcare team to the Cleveland Clinic and engaging in some discussion with economic developers in the Cleveland area. They've turned what was, we'll call it, an economic boom for their area in turning over their economic driver in healthcare now into a tourism experience where folks not only come there for procedures or come for innovation, but they get to experience the city and they're realizing real value there. So is that something that we want to look at as a longer term initiative for us and how agriculture may have an impact there? We know that there are organizations in our community that are already doing this. The probably more widely spread example is going to be Nature Fresh, who takes their how it's grown on the road. They have a mobile transport trailer and a mobile setup where they are taking this experience to kids in urban centers and explaining to them how it works. You know, the opposite may be true, that we may be having kids coming to this community and visiting a greenhouse to understand where their vegetables come from. My husband is a city guy, and he didn't actually know that tomatoes didn't come from anywhere but the grocery store. So, I mean, this is really, in some cases, what we're dealing with when we talk about folks that are really urbanized. So this could be a potential for us. But let's just not focus on too much of that right now. I think you all know that arguably I'm one person, and so in order to realize a large plan like this, it takes a community of folks to get started on that. So what I'm going to show you here is just, I know this is difficult to read, but under each one of these pillars, I know, I apologize, but I believe you have a copy of the presentation, and certainly you're at liberty to come and talk to me about this. I wanted you to see, so for those of you that can squint and see the little green areas under each one of these pillars, those are either projects inside of these initiatives that have been completed or started or in process in some way. So just to save you the strain on your eyes, I'll give you a quick rundown. So under community partner engagement, so these are things like relationship building to ensure that our partners understand our strategic needs for community growth. So we've engaged in that activity. Certainly some of it just by sheer introduction of who we are and what we're planning to do and giving them the big picture. But we are organizing a community partner forum for February of 2016. This is in an effort to make sure that our community partners have a forum where they can stand up and talk about what they do for other community partners. What I'm finding is there's a huge gap. There may be some competition and certainly some redundancy between the delivery of what each community partner is doing. But the second half to this day will then be exposing them to these seven areas of consideration and asking them, where do they fit and how do they want to participate, so that we can accelerate some of the activity happening inside here. So that will be key for us moving forward to address issues like poverty reduction. So a reminder, the United Way On Track to Success program, which is in process, the municipality is a sponsor of, is aimed at poverty reduction and stopping the cycle of poverty, but it's also aimed at youth engagement. And to Denise's and Wendy's point about the findings of keeping folks in high school for secondary and post-secondary education, this program will be key. The Junior Achievement Program launch that we did here a couple of months ago, again, aimed at teaching financial responsibility to young folks so they don't find themselves in situational poverty, is another program that's moving forward, as well as Habitat for Humanity coming to our community, which takes folks out of situational poverty by giving them a means to have a home, you know, in some cases at a reasonable cost, something that they wouldn't ordinarily be able to attain, which will improve their quality of life. Under workforce development, I don't think I need to go into too much detail there, but workforce development is really an exercise of community development that impacts economic development. So it will be key for us to understand not only what positions or occupations are poised for growth in the future tied to our key economic sectors, but what kind of skills are required for that, and then how do we make sure that information gets leveraged inside of our high schools, inside of our education groups, and inside of our community. Cultural diversity, which again I said links to in some cases a cultural plan for tourism, but things like migrant worker support. We know even though we have, you know, at any given time roughly 7,000 people here from 11 different countries that are not full-time residents of Canada, the impact that they have socioeconomically in our community is a full-time impact. So how do we support that? How do we engage in that? How do we look for funding around that? Where can we look for sources that will help us bridge the gaps in not only making sure that these folks feel welcomed in our community and have access to the things they need to have access to, but how do we prepare our long-term and our year-round residents for embracing cultural diversity? We talked about immigration and settlement attractions. So one of the things that our workforce project has not released yet is that typically our growth for a community this size for the age demographics that are missing are likely going to come from a newcomer strategy. So what that means is we'll have people coming from other countries and settling here in Leamington that fill in that age group, because we're clearly not producing those babies right now. We have Caldwell First Nation in our own backyard, and what are the things that we're doing in order to support growth and development inside of that nation, which also links to a cultural diversity package, or a strategy, if you will. And then the Windsor-Essex Local Immigration Project, which Leamington is a member of. How do we continue to engage with service providers to create a welcoming community? And that's an ongoing discussion. Urban renewal. We know we've had a CIP program in place for some time, and it's going to be ending soon. So some review under there. And lots of other programs here that have come out of discussions where folks have had some ideas about what we could perhaps do there. I think it warrants saying that inside of all of these plans are ideas that have come from internal folks, from external partners about what we could be considering. Not all of them had been vetted, and not all of them have been discussed internally about the impacts or the supports that are going to be required there. So there's some things here that are really just a point or topic ready for investigation or feasibility. Youth engagement. So youth entrepreneur programs, we've talked about using the Mayor's Youth Council as a potential vehicle for youth engagement, and what are some of the objectives we'd like to see come out of that. Engaging our high schools, engaging other youth groups in order to help them understand the potential that exists here in Leamington and the opportunity for them to stay here. And a new project that I brought to our attention, which is linking seniors and youths through some activities to do with understanding the internet. So there'll be more to come on that. I'll be anxious to share that with you shortly. And then Healthy Community, who we have our partners right here at Leamington District Memorial Hospital, are helping us with that. It's not only about building the community and the network, it's also about making sure that folks who are marginalized or folks who don't have access can get access. So that's the community development portfolio. Economic development. I don't know, there's lots of activity going on in economic development. I can tell you that the business retention and expansion visits continue. I try and get in to see a business owner at least one per week. In some cases, it ends up being 10 per week. It just depends on when folks are available and when they want to have discussion. The requests for help, support, introductions, and information continue to be on the rise. So my list gets very, very long on folks that need some follow-up. So that continues to keep me very, very busy. Some of the key activities, though, inside these sectors with the agribusiness, we're looking at and the feasibility of having an energy buying program that was born here in Leamington, which will take off once it's in place, but we are very, very close to having the finishing touches put on that. Essentially what it does is not create more energy for our greenhouse sector or for our agribusiness sector, but minimize their cost by reducing their per kilowatt hour charge and takes the volatility out of high peak versus low peak rates and provides them a fixed cost for energy now that they can use as a budget line item, in some cases saving them anywhere between 15% and 40% on their energy pricing. So, I mean, to me, if I can offset energy pricing, that means they have money to spend on other things, which makes it a great growth potential here in Leamington. We did also, in October, launch small business supports here in Leamington. I'm happy to say the first session was today. We will be running monthly sessions here in Leamington before there will be any discussion about a full-time investment here for a small business center. But we've seen great uptake and great interest, including an email, nice little email that I got today, summarizing all of the activity that happened. So what we're starting to see here, what we discovered during the initial six-month phase of my tenure here, was that folks who needed the support couldn't get the support because, like many other institutions, they had to go to Essex or Windsor in order to get it. For an owner-operator who is working inside their establishment, they don't necessarily have the resource to be able to close their doors, to spend 45 minutes on the road, to go learn something for 2 hours, to spend 45 minutes on the road to come back in order to get the supports they need. So it was key to me to bring those supports here. So with the help of the Small Business Center, as well as Community Futures Development Corporation, we launched small business services here in Leamington in October. What that's meant to do is provide open online format learning for things like business planning, market strategies, engaging in social media, right down to the niche market of innovation, how do they continue to innovate their businesses. But it also allows them opportunity with one-on-one business coaches who can answer their specific concerns, and that's by appointment only today. This morning's sessions had 9 businesses in it, which to me is a huge success. I know we would love to see 85, but I always have high expectations, but 9 is a great start for the very first month that we launched this. And out of those 9 that attended the business planning portion this morning, I think 3 of them stayed after the session for one-on-one appointments with a business advisor. So this is key for growth. I want to point out, John, and it's later on in my presentation, though, you asked the question, how can we be 10th in the entrepreneur side of things? Because it's only measuring the number of people that open businesses. It's not necessarily measuring the number of people that continue to stay in business, but we'll talk about that more later. And then, of course, our friends here in healthcare, I saved them to last because they've been so much fun to hang out with and have exposed me to a whole new world of where growth is happening in healthcare. And I'm very excited to say that with healthcare is a unique anomaly for us in this community. One, it is a significant employer. Two, there's great opportunity in the innovation side. And three, because we run a rural hospital and we're not an urban center, that creates a ripe opportunity for us to look at sharing what we've learned with other communities in not only Ontario but across the country. So we're poised for greatness here. The second part is that innovation inside of healthcare today is engaging in other sectors. What that means for Leamington is we have a bit of an organic solution here. that we have somebody who might be interested in innovation, but they can engage with a manufacturer for a product development, or they can engage with a web developer for an online solution, like Zane alluded to earlier, or they can engage with a greenhouse producer to talk about nutrition. So we have an ecosystem, if you will, of activity happening inside of healthcare innovation here, which is very exciting when we talk about growth potential inside of a sector for our specific area. I'm going to take a breath now. Okay, and not too much detail here. Again, this is just a reiteration of the number of, we'll call them, pillars inside of tourism that we could potentially be taking advantage of here by having a larger, more well-developed strategy. And a quick overview of the number of things that my office has been involved in the last year. So things like the Burning Festival. We had a bunch of pilots visit. I think many of you attended when we had the pilots come into town. We got lots of great feedback on that event. The Mosaic and Discover Leamington Weekend, involved in Hogs for Hospice, and you'll hear more information about that later. Kingsville Folk Festival and supporting that, the Seawatts Launch, Pelee Island and Point Pelee collaboration and development is ongoing. Southwestern Ontario Fire Trade Show, which for those of you that attended also got a significant amount of buzz and praise. And then we have some other overlap with services and businesses that cater to this sector. So lots of activity going on there. So, another deep breath, knowing that you all like to see results. Here's a couple of the things that we can share at this point. Based on all of this activity to date, we know that our building stats are up, which suggests we have growth here, and it's a combination of not only residential growth, but commercial and industrial growth. Our job growth, a very exciting number. So to Councillor Jacob's question of our workforce development folks earlier, what kinds of businesses are growing? Of the businesses that I'm engaged with to date, it's actually a little bit out. It's actually 388 jobs now that we are aware of that are growth potential for our community in the next 18 months. I know of three other organizations that are also in growth mode, and they haven't shared their updates. So, and those are the ones that I know. We also know there are a ton of folks that are growing and adding to their labor force right now that I am not aware of. So these numbers should be encouraging to you. The goal here is to not only improve folks working in these facilities, but longer term look at an attraction package that gets them to locate in this community as well. A significant increase in requests for information, introductions, funding, and support through the Economic Development Office. So now that folks realize I'm here, I'm starting to get lots and lots of phone calls, which is really encouraging because that means that they have some faith and some trust in where we're going and know that we have the supports to be able to guide them as far as growth is concerned. The Financial Post and the Canadian Federation of Independent Business report saying that we went from 37th ranking last year to 10th ranking this year, and we're poised to meet our previous ranking in 2008 of third place if we continue on this growth path. And of these businesses, like I said, John, it's just the number of businesses that are opening, not necessarily the number of businesses that are sustaining or growing. In some cases, small business is not poised for growth as far as jobs are concerned. They look at market market access or market share, and in some cases, they can grow with market share without adding labor. So we're going to look now not only at how many businesses are opening, but how many businesses are staying open year over year and how many of them are expanding their markets. Also, increased requests for partnerships and events and community initiatives. So if it isn't somebody calling to ask for help where they can get funding or where they can find information about business growth, they're asking if I will help in organizing an event. I'm actually going to add that to my portfolio. I think when this gig is done, I'm going into wedding planning. But the fact now that folks have realized that the municipality can be a huge partner, and they want to engage with us in partnership, I think should speak to the volume, again, of faith that people have and where we're going, and that's in many cases attributed to a lot of the work that you as a councillor are also doing. Increased attention from site selection and real estate professionals outside of Leamington, so I'm still getting a lot of folks starting to pay attention now because of a lot of our press and our communication plan, or the by gosh and by golly system of how we're sharing this information. Folks are starting to stand up and say, wow, what's going on over there? And an increased online attention and expanded communication and audience engagement. So this is not enough now to just say that folks are aware of who we are, that they're linking with us, they're connecting with us on Twitter, they're connecting with us on Facebook, and they want to engage in a discussion about what's happening to Leamington. So with further, basically something's happening. So that's all I have to share with you tonight. So comments, questions?